speaks vanish when we're filling them. Handling, we do our thing, and we're gonna win. Revolution will not be televised, we're marching in. Listening to the sound, body on, painting in. Plus I'm leaning in to the left, melanin. Generating another level of thought development. Altering anomaly sentiments with intellect. See, I found beauty in the strength of our unity and unison with our people's history and legacy. A most sensitive sentiment of a falling star. Everybody say, rest in peace, Salazar. I break bread with veterans of the urban board. Past, present tense, still rocking Pendletons. I only move when the people say it's movement. So assume that a rebel is your future president. Browning of America.
How's everybody doing? Make some noise, come on, I came all the way from LA to hear some noise. I'm here to talk about immigration, migration, and globalization. Really, the idea is not that I'm against globalization, I'm not anti-globalization, but I am against certain things with regards to globalization. If it was up to me, I globalize hip-hop. I globalize justice and freedom. So that one's economic level would not determine the value of care and therefore the value of one's life, I globalize free healthcare. So that everyone can get a just education, I globalize free tuition for all students, regardless of migration, economic, or social status. I globalize, yes indeed, yes. So that no government can ever tell a woman what they can and cannot do with their own body. I globalize women reproductive justice. I globalize free skate parks. So that no child ever goes hungry. I globalize a hungry free world by creating a policy that would allow and highlight the virtue of people giving and deprive senseless waste from existence. I globalize music programs. Free ones at that. Art programs, sports programs. I globalize a healthy migration. Because I do feel that people should have the option to migrate. So I'm not against globalization, but I am against neoliberal politics that come from globalization and that only promote the free flow of goods and products while denying the free flow of people, of ideas, of dignity. Mama, help me. Y'all know what this is here? That's hip-hop in the 1970s and 80s. It's a beautiful thing to have free concerts at parks. People learning to DJ, makeshift sound systems with the fan to make sure things don't blow up. It's a beautiful thing, but now hip-hop is a multi-billion dollar industry. It's gotten away from the people. Now, we've all seen the images and videos of people fleeing the borders of Hungary and Europe. And the mass bodies are counted, dead on arrival. Some survived, but dead inside. It's an astounding reality of the human experience. Yet we have learned to be accustomed to it. In fact, some will say that we've been desensitized to the reality of immigration. We've tired ourselves of the subject. Natural disasters, wars, human destruction, economic depression and disparity, disasters causes displacement. Displacement is the genesis of forced migration. The batteries are running low on this, yo. Y'all good? Everything good? Yeah. All right, cool. Can we keep it going?
Yeah.
Today we cannot talk about immigration without talking about the Mexican experience, that is the Mexican diaspora. And with that, foreign policies that have continued to feed into forced migration. We've seen images and videos of the reality of the U.S.-Mexico border. Legs hurt over steel poles, bodies dressed in loose clothing, often a sweater around their waist, canvas-colored hat, bent brim and back tight against their back. Too many to count. Too many lost in the desert. Too many lost in the city. Too many contributing to the economy to lose them. The last 20 years, the pace of global integration has dramatically changed. According to the Global Policy Institute, unprecedented changes in communication, transportation, and computer technology have given the process new impetus and made the world more independent than ever. Globalization is often revered as an economic miracle, a process by which participating governments agree on a foreign policy that would allow for the free flow of goods without the restrictions that have historically kept them from working together. Free trade means just that. Tariffs, taxes would be lifted, subsidies would be granted, and simply it would make it a lot easier for companies to work together around the world. It often states that it promotes economic growth, creates jobs, makes companies more competitive, and lowers prices for consumers. The battle between politics, commercial interest, and culture revolves around access to global markets. Those who have the ability to produce overseas can also sell overseas. The logic is simple, and we all understand it very well. Why buy something more expensive when you can buy it somewhere a lot cheaper? Why go to three different stores when you can go to a retail store and buy all three things at once and get a latte or a cappuccino on your way out? I'll give you an example. Corn is one thing that's really important for us as people from Latin America or Mexico. Corn is not just a crop for sustainability. It's also a spiritual one that helps us root culture in Mexico. Before 1994, the Mexican government supported small farmers in Mexico by providing subsidies. Corn in Mexico is a lot more expensive than it is in the U.S. 3.5 pesos, which I don't even know how to translate that into dollars and cents, basically. That's the price of the corn in the U.S., and it's double that in Mexico. In order for Mexico to participate in NAFTA, the North American Free Trade Agreement, it had to put everything on the same playing field. It now provided subsidies to U.S. companies, making it less expensive to export to Mexico. Suddenly, it became cheaper to purchase corn from the U.S. than for farmers to cultivate their own. It created a decline in production and an increase in import dependency. Corn prices in Mexico fell 70%, advancing 20 million farmers out of work. In addition, Mexico now imports 95% of its soy, 58% of its rice, 50% of its wheat, 25% of its corn, and 40% of its meat. 25% of the population does not have access to basic food, and thousands of children suffer from malnutrition. The environmental impact is great as well. According to the New York Times, transnational industrial corridors in rural areas have contaminated rivers and sickened the population. And typically, women bear the heaviest impact. According to the Economic Policy Institute, NAFTA has cost the U.S. over 420,000 jobs since 1993. NAFTA has also been responsible for about 38% of the decline in manufacturing employment in the U.S. Since NAFTA, 2.3 million left agricultural work in Mexico. 5 million unpaid family farm members left the farm. That makes over 7 million people who were forced into the migration stream. NAFTA's disaster in Mexico has a very clear and direct impact in U.S. Mexicans without jobs in rural areas moved to urban areas where most of the jobs were promised with North American Free Trade Agreement. Not all, but some. Cities now are not able to hold the rapid influx of migration and cause Mexican cities' infrastructure to collapse. Too many migration in the U.S. because that's the only solution. If you're somebody that lives in Oaxaca or in Chiapas, the southernmost part of Mexico, and you spend all your money to try to get to the northern part of Mexico to try to get one of the jobs the NAFTA promised in Mexico, you get there and there's no job, the border seems a lot closer. To me, it's heavy and it's very political, but politics is circumstantial, and I feel that we have to humanize these experiences. So is it okay if I share a spoken word piece with y'all? Woo! Check, all right. So now what I want you to do is, anytime I say something that you can relate to, or you connected with, or agree with, I want you to clap your hands or stomp your feet. I don't want you to snap your fingers because the world won't be able to hear, and we want to globalize this experience, all right? So I want you to make noise anytime you hear something that you're connected with. Are you ready for this? Now, I didn't come from a broken home. Instead, just the opposite. A loving family, but problems though. Victim of my surroundings. Don't worry about interrupting me. You go ahead, I'm from LA, I hear a lot of noise all the time. Our biggest obstacle was lack of education and poverty. Forced to do what was needed for a bit of food insecurity. It's hard to see the warmth of my family's love turned into a cold hug because the money problems unresolved. Two jobs ain't enough. Still they grind harder than most. I'm mad at the world because we're not given no choice. But how did we get here? See, our folks were forced out of the country. You must be crazy, no one crosses the desert because they want to. It's a necessity, a sacrifice for the family. You don't call them illegals, you call them economic refugees. Now in this part of the song, I will tell you, imagine how you felt. But I know you don't need to imagine. Cause if you've been poor, then you know the feeling real to you and vivid. Cause you felt it, tasted, smelt it. In other words, you also lived it. I turned my head away from anger. Cause it would have been easy to pick up the pistol and bang on the ones I thought were responsible. Instead, I dreamt in Spanish and stared at my hands. I saw the color of my skin reminding me the days my grandpa said. Mijo, la cultura cura. La sangre indígena es pura. I stopped talking and suddenly I heard the whispers in the city. I share your pain, they said, we also want to be free. So instead of throwing up signs or throwing rocks at buildings, I threw my fist in the air and joined the rest of the children. See, I cannot turn the other cheek, cause it's easy to forget, but it is hardest to regret. I'm not a gangster, I don't bang, I'm not a hustler, I don't slang, but a ghetto kid, that's the reason for my swagger and my slang. I'm not dying for the block, see, I don't own nothing there, but for my people, I'll give my life and work until we win the fight. And so I go to school instead of streets, reject my football scholarship and focus on the books to get my grades up and show the hood. Anything is possible. Another grind I know I could and finish to make my people proud like I said I would. But even then I saw the struggle, a prison of sorts, a culture was shocked. My introduction to these coconuts, did not understand why teachers turned protesters till I realized that they're also blue collar workers. Janitors protest, students stand and fight. In the hell of the sweatshops, they deny the workers' rights. Culture will battle for dignity and tradition. I wanna be home with them every second, and so I go. Claim my space within the struggle. Learn my grandpa's words and try to live a different life and do my part and always grow. Celebrate the life that we've been given. Just another kid like you who's driven. Cause if you didn't know, then now you know the feeling. Feel it. The idea is that people don't choose to migrate, is that we are forced to migrate. A very prestigious magazine did an article on some of my music, specifically that song that you heard right there called The Browning of America. And the album, my album is called Brown is Beautiful. And she asked, why Brown is Beautiful? After I got over the fact that that was a racist question, I said, because we are. Punto y aparte means period. The next question was, what is the issue with Browning of America? Why is this such a big issue? Why do you have a song about it? And I told her, it was simple. The song is not a political testament. It's not a political ideology. But it's something very basic. It's a truth and it's a reality that is existing in the United States. As y'all saw in that video, there's enough facts for you to know and understand that the population of the brown community is growing by the numbers in the United States. That is not a fear. You shouldn't be feared or threatened by this. To say brown is beautiful is not to say that everybody else isn't. It's simply to say a people who have been historically marginalized is now taking their proper space with dignity and humanity in this world and saying, we are beautiful. When Black Lives Matter says Black Lives Matter, it doesn't then entail that other people don't matter. It simply says that people who have historically been repressed by that same system is now taking their proper place in this society and saying, we matter. Now, I want you to understand really what this means in terms of migration and immigration. So when we see somebody here who is Mexican, we say, go back to your country or something like that. We forget that before 1848, the United States was part of Mexico. When we say go back to your country, some of us don't understand that seven generations ago, Texas was Mexico. When we say go back to your country, for some of us, it means this is our country. We've been here since we were born. I got nowhere else to go but here. So when you say go back to your country, all I do is say, all right, cool, I'm gonna go back to William Boulevard and East LA. Globalization not only causes forced migration, but it destroys the social infrastructure of a community, and in some cases, countries. The standard of living changes. Although opportunities are exposed to everyone, only a certain few have access to them. Forced migration is nothing more than a byproduct of global transnationalism. It's also not an end product. This is about money, and the truth is, local economies are destroyed. While mega supermarkets like Chedraui or Soriana or even Walmart in Mexico, the likelihood of mom and pop shops surviving are extremely unlikely, and we all understand this. We know this from a local perspective. It's impossible to compete with prices and the product selection. These policies haven't stopped. Since NAFTA, there's been other significant agreements between both countries. The Medida initiative is one of them. It's an unprecedented partnership between the United States and Mexico to fight organized crime. I'm sure y'all have heard about the cartels and associated violence that comes with that. Anti-corruption programs that include vetting of police personnel and the creation of trained internal affairs units have been instituted. Since the program started, police capacity building courses for Mexico law enforcement have been delivered to the police personnel. In other words, the U.S. has gone to Mexico already to do training. The same police that we're fighting against here in the United States for killing black youth. With all due respect, we don't need your help. You need to help yourselves. This is the same police that's been training the Mexican government and the police forces in Mexico, the same ones that made 43 students disappear. Raise your hand if you heard of the Ayotzinapa students. These are 43 kids from Mexico in a rural university who are being taught or being students for to be teachers, but going back to their communities. 43 of them were disappeared. Mexican government said it was the cartels are saying it's the federal police. The federal police are saying it's the state police. State police is saying that it's the government. Corruption hasn't stopped since the Medida initiative. Migration hasn't stopped since the North American Free Trade Agreement. Now, I'm gonna leave you with a little story. The story to me is really important because it's an indigenous man from Mexico who I had the opportunity to meet. And I heard him talking to a politician. A politician came up to him and said, basically there's this Mexican program funded by the U.S. That would help them live better. Now, we're gonna call the elder, the indigenous elder, we're gonna call him Don Juan, okay? And we're gonna call the politician Donald. Is that cool? You have to excuse me because this is a new laptop for me. It's a PC and I'll mess with these too much. All right, here we go. So Donald says to the old man, rather than using fire to cook, you can now have electricity. And Don Juan says, but fire not only allows me to cook food, but it also keeps me warm and gives me light. Donald says, but rather than using the river for bathing, you will now have running water to bathe and wash. Don Juan says, but the river gives us water, brings us food, and keeps us cool. The Don said, change your sandals for boots, your traditional garment for pants and shirt. This will make you more presentable at work. Don Juan says, but my sandals draw me closer to the earth. They allow me to feel the soil. My traditional garment was made to function better while working the land and made for comfort to respond to the seasons. And most importantly, I work in my community. We all dress the same way because we all have the same type of work and the same responsibilities. Our contributions to our community through the work we accomplish is what gives us individual respect and mutual respect, not what I wear. And Donald said, Take advantage of the program. Your kids will be able to attend the new school just a few miles away. Don Juan says, the new school discourages their native language, and that's like discouraging their existence. My children are real and present, educated in the art of harvest, and speak the language of the earth. Then Donald said, if you move here, because the program was offering a new house, if you move here, you will visit the grocery store once, but buy everything you need. Don Juan said, if I don't work the land, then the land will die. If the land dies, so too does our culture. And with it, we will die. It's from here that we draw our identity. He says, no land, no culture. No culture, no life. So no, sir, I will not contribute to my own death today. Today, I choose to live. That was his response. I'll end with this because I know my time is up. I didn't even know there was something in front of me telling me so. So my apologies. Today we have to intervene and ensure that immigration is a much larger conversation. It is vital that the plight of the Latino-Latina community is present in the media and that the conversation is beyond immigration. That it's about our legacy and our resilience as a people so that we can take our proper place in the history of this nation. Thank you very much.